tickets. What if we do a strategy? What if we bought that, use it as an anchor, and began to leverage that with our other content? So I went after that. And then I found out we had to buy Kings and the Lakers, Forum, and all that. And so I set on the road of trying to do it.
That deal fell through, as did bids to purchase the Miami Heat and the Oakland A's. Cooper, though, remained undeterred. The veteran of the movie industry, where success is never guaranteed, remained focused on landing a sports franchise.
Why don't you make movies, you know, that flops and hits, flops and hits, flops and hits?
Oh,
I get the strategy. Just make hits. Why didn't I think of that? You know, the issue is, you know, everybody has success and failure. Failure never will go the flash on the road to success. Can't manage failure, you're never going to really be successful. Or you're not going to find out how successful you can be.
The setbacks continued for Uber and his new partner, Joe Lacob, when they joined fellow Bostonian Frank McCourt in hopes of buying the Dodgers in the early 2000s. McCourt broke with Uber and Lacob and closed the deal without them, but the two forged a bond in the process that would eventually pay off 400 miles up the California coast.
Sometimes these things are just natural chemistry between the two people. And I think from the time I met Peter, we just kind of, maybe because we're both from the Boston area, we hit it off right from the very beginning. We're very similar in a lot of personality characteristics.
So it is my privilege to bring up two very important people now, the new owners of the Golden State Warriors, Joe Lacob and Peter Guber.
In the most honor for both, after you guys closed the deal, any part of you looking around and saying, I can't believe we did this?
I was happily thrilled, and I exhaled, you know, okay. Oh, we did that. And then I went, oh my God, what have we done? I had both feelings at the same time. Now, the journey begins actually once you make the deal. The journey is the end of it. It's the beginning of it. You fool to make a deal. You know, you fool yourself to make the wrong deal for the wrong product. You're going to be the problem.
This is a picture that if you're doing right, it's going to cross your nose. Right. All right, so that was the problem. So we have to think about what kind of person, what kind of person. And it has to be international.
Yeah. How is it similar? How is it different buying a team as opposed to posing on a big movie?
It's not all that different. You know, it's about aspirations for the first place. All the things that you do, it's really successful. And a lot of challenges to it. And the emotional feeling is very similar. 9 years of that, back in the making of pictures.
I think there's some fringe on 25. George Lopez, who wants to go to the Warrior game, one of the last three games. How is your background in entertainment help you in the NBA? Is that cross over in the NBA? Oh my God.
Garage door.
Anybody who doesn't think they're in the location based entertainment in the sport, you know what they call it? That's a perfect thing.
What do you want to call entertainment? It happens to be in the form of sports. But what he did before this was entertainment, whether it's the movies, the games like that. What's that in the same thing here?
Thank you.
coffee creamer is made of? Natural Bliss is how you're pouring a few natural ingredients into your drinks. Milk, cream, pure cane sugar, and natural flavors.
Papau. Hey, Anna. Pau, pau. Pau, pau. Can't say it. Stop banging that. Ah, why it?
He locked it.
Yeah, he locked the lock, guys. That's the white book, eh?
Proudly embracing all of their history, celebrating diversity, working to break down social barriers, all through a shared love and respect for good food. That's what makes Lima's food a gift to Peru, and Peru's gift to the world. So remember, when you're in Lima, if it looks good,
bueno,
eat it. Food is a universal language that speaks to all the senses. The hot chilies, if you like a straight turkey, the resident Inca foods are found far from the grounds and all the unexpected places. That mahi mahi had just had lunch before he was cooked. These classics sometimes come in some pretty strange shapes and sizes. This looks like little pieces that cover the toes themselves. Others should come with warning labels.
This guy got to get.
I don't need that. You gotta get all of these. They're delicious. I'm Andrew Zimmer, and this is the Bizarre Foods Continental Classic Special.
¿Cómo está, Jay?
When it's bringing people closer together, globalization can be a very good thing. When travel comes, when it starts all of us into one big parking lot of sameness. Thankfully, products of resistance are holding out against the onslaught of retail food chains.
It's a taste
of what makes each culture unique. On the continent of Asia, there's explosive growth and runaway urbanization. When people from all over China are concentrated in a city like Beijing, you can find authentic taste of an entire country jammed into a space like one Fujian shopping street. In this market, you can get scallops, pearls, or flies, and skewered, seasoned, and grilled as a snack. This is a type of cicada grilled to perfection. Oh my gosh. Bugs like this tend to taste of what they eat off of, and I can only think that this one was collected in some barn with a lot of giant bull animals took a very sturdy dump.
Who said,
this is horrifying. Now, traditionally, seahorses are found in
seahorse, yeah, you can see one. Look,
I just couldn't resist trying one. Here goes.
I was watching first.
Oh,
yeah,
see,
These are gross. They're crunchy. They're way too salty. They're really fishy.
Any problem? Any problem?
At night, the action shifts a few blocks away to the Don Wei Min Market. There's dumplings galore, even giant steamed dumplings filled with soup, and all kinds of seafood, like burger oysters, barbecue eel, and even raw sea urchins. Oh yeah, that's a good one.
Raw sea urchins!
Beautiful. You can pay $20 a portion for a sea urchin at a fancy sushi restaurant in Los Angeles or New York, or you can pay $1 here in Beijing. Sea urchins are often raw or boiled.
They
simply halved and doused with nut oil. The six foamy coral strips that lay inside are the salty roasted eggs or eggs. These are good sea urchin. Celebrating that kind of diversity is an inspiration for a new generation of chefs. That's especially true in a country like Cambodia, where about half the population is under the age of 22. Those young people are still working to reconstruct a venerable culture almost obliterated by the atrocities of the Khmer Rouge. Lou Meng is a classically trained chef and the owner of the Molly's Restaurant.
No, you go back. Back up.
A Cambodian meal typically includes rice and several dishes that combine sweet, sour, salty, and bitter tastes. Two of the most vital ingredients in Khmer cuisine what? Are krum and prahok.
It's a fish, a river fish, which is they marinate with salt, garlic, a little bit of sugar, and they preserve it for months and months.
This smells like about 1,000 old gym socks, just stuffed into a bag and left to sit somewhere for a while. This rotting pile of fish turns into a paste and is used as a seasoning in many traditional dishes. Krum, the other pillar of Khmer cooking, is similar to curry paste, a puree of ginger, lemon, seasonings, and pure lime. The flavor is uniquely Cambodian. With these two essential ingredients in hand, Meng prepares a classic Cambodian dish. Gobi is a freshwater fish caught in the nearby Mekong River. In goes the krum, some coconut milk, and prahok.
Just get a little bit of this to get the flavors.
Wow, that was a little bit. The prahok is so strong and pungent that a teaspoonful can flavor this entire dish. The mixture is steamed in cups made out of a banana leaf.
Let me get up.
After 20 minutes of steaming, the gobi is ready to eat.
You feel the sweet behind the fish and the lemon grass.
And then you feel that prahok coming through your nose. And then the very last thing that happens is that the hot chilies hit you like a freight train. Your grandma
right?
I love your grandma. Some of the best discoveries I've made in Asia are when you get off the beaten track, like the Thailand province of Phang Nga, north of Phuket. I decided to stop in this tiny little fishing village called Tok La Mu, and there's a lady right down the street who supposedly makes killer fish cakes, some great dried fish, and is renowned for her fish stomach sauce, a national staple when it comes to Thai cooking. Fish stomach sauce isn't much more than what it sounds like. Strained as a seasoning or cooked with the stomachs as part of a curry, it adds a complex saltiness to plenty of Thai dishes. Think of it as the Thai equivalent to the American love of ketchup or the Chinese use of soy sauce. There are factories churning out fish stomach sauce all across Thailand today, but Bonnet's crew is famous in this area for their homemade version. What she's cutting open here are mahi-mahi dolphin fish. Really, this one has got to be about a 30-pounder. Since the stomach is the key ingredient, Bonnet uses pretty much any species of local fish. Mullet, sardines, whitefish, snappers, or anything else that comes in the daily catch.
And there's the stomach. You can even see that there's little bits of other fish in there. Look at that.
That mahi-mahi had just had lunch before he was caught. Once the stomachs are retrieved, they're thoroughly cleaned. Then tossed with rock salt and squished into old crap whiskey bottles.
No.
The bottles should left to ferment for anywhere from 1 month to several months.
Okay, go.
However, Bonnet also makes some crackers.